Welcome you all to Ayurveda Network BHU. Myself, I am Dr. Satya M. Dornala, working as Panchkarma Specialist at Swami Vivekananda Ayurvedic Panchkarma Hospital, New Delhi. I am going to discuss about the scientific appraisal of Sveda Karma. We all know there is a super speciality branch of Ayurveda, therapeutic super speciality branch of Ayurveda, that is Panchakarma. And under this heading, that is Panchakarma, we do different kinds of procedures. And the very basic procedure we starts with the Abhyanga and Sveda Karma. And this, the perception in day-to-day life regarding the Sveda Karma as a whole, and conventionally simply it is called as a heat therapy. But therapeutically it has broad spectrum effects. We will see how this can, the effects of the broad spectrum effects of Sveda Karma can be understood in a more of scientific manner. Coming to the introductory part. We all know that whenever we feel nervous or scared, anxious or afraid, or when we do aerobic workout, usually we observe sweat on our forehead and axilla and other bodily parts. This is a normal physiological perspiration. And for the perspiration, animals is supposed to maintain the body temperature. And that is the reason with the human beings considered as an endotherms, that is warm-blooded animals. We maintain a stable internal body temperature regardless of external influences. That's how we have a mechanism of thermoregulation. And there are animals, and this for thermoregulation, animals is supposed to have a sweat glands, and which participate in the, which are responsible for the perspiration. And there are animals where we don't see we see the absence of sweat glands or the minimal number of sweat glands. For example, we may take the example as a dog. And whenever you look at the dog, we usually see open mouth dog. So this the way the dog tries to cool its own body, it's a kind of body's cooling mechanism, and that particular mechanism is called as panting mechanism. And the panting mechanism helps the dog to cool its own body. And the logic behind this Sveda Karma, it's beautifully put forth by the Acharya Charaka. Sushkanyapi hi kastani sneha svedopapadani Namayanti Yadanyayam Kim Punarjivato Naran. Even when dry pieces of wood bend by means of application of foliation and sedation, then how can living beings not be benefited? Of course, that's true. And this particular Sveda Karma forms the basis of the science of physical medicine in Ayurveda. Then coming to the, what is Sveda and the Kleda? This Sveda is considered as mala of medodhatu, that is byproduct medas. It is mala, but we tend to translate the mala as a waste product in conventional medicine. But in Ayurveda, the three malas, mala, mutra, sveda, feces, urine and sweat, these considered as, and these have normal physiological functions in addition to other dhatus. So, it's not appropriate to use the word waste products, rather it is more appropriate to use the byproducts. And the factor which is responsible for the perspiration is Samana Vata, which is present all over the body. And the normal physiological function of Sveda is Kleda Vidruti. And it may be understood in a sense it is responsible for fluid and electrolyte balance. And how these three malas, that is mala, mutra, sveda, are being nourished, the kitta of ahara
nourishes the malas of the body. Sweat, sensible perspiration. Sweat is a clear secretion produced by sweat glands. It is mostly the water, that is 99% water, and some electrolytes, chiefly sodium chloride, metabolites and waste products. Apocrine sweat glands secretes proteins and even the fatty acids. In human sweat is hyposmetic, relatively to the plasma. Then what is Sveda Karma? Stambha Gaurava Sheetagnam Svedanam Svedakarakam. The process by which the stambha, that is stiffness, gaura heaviness, and sheetagna coldness is mitigated is Sveda Karma, by the process of Sveda Karakam, that is perspiration. And this particular kriya, that is Sveda Karma, may be applied as a Purva Karma, maybe that as a pre-operative procedure in classical Panchakarma, and as Pradhana Karma in Chadupa Karmas, and Paschat Karma after Vasti and Sveda Sukupa, after Prasava and Mudagarbha Chikitsa and removing Shalya, there we apply the Sveda Karma as Paschat Karma, the post-operative procedure. And there are therapies in management, that is in Bagandhara management, Arshas management, in Ashmari management, we apply the Sveda Karma as a Purva and Paschat, both in the pre-operative phase and in the post-operative phase. Svedanam Sneha Samyuktam. The term Sveda by default should be taken Sveda with Snehan, internal or external. In most of the spa centers, they directly apply this sweat therapy. They subject the body to, this perspiration. But Ayurveda strongly advises always the Sveda should be preceded by the Snehana Karma. Prakruta Sveda, euhydrosis. Though this particular Sveda Karma is something which we artificially induce, but there are contexts normally body perspires. And in Basavaraja Jvara Chikitsa, Acharya Basavaraj clearly mentioned that there are 5 types of Prakruta Sveda. Jvara Mukte, Mala Mukte, Prana Mukte, Samirane. Sannipatodbodhshaiva Svedobhavati Panchama. And that too, in Jvaramukte, we observe perspiration all over the body. In Malamukte, we observe on Lalata. And in Pranamukte, we observe perspiration Kanta region. And Samirane, when we apply something, smearing any lep application, we see Muhur Muhur Sveda. And in Sannipata also we see the Muhur Muhur Sveda perspiration. And this is essential to know what is Prakruta Sveda. So, until unless then it becomes difficult to differentiate what is the difference between Prakruta and Vaikruta of Sveda. And what exactly is sweating in modern physiology? It is a body's major way of getting rid of excess body heat which is produced by metabolism or working muscles. It can be made in response to nerve stimulation, hot air, temperature and or exercise. Hypothalamus, that is preoptic and anterior regions of hypothalamus, functions as sensing area of thermosensitive neurons, and 1 liter of sweat per hour, it removes 540 kilocalories of heat from the body. And usually sweating begins at a critical skin temperature about 34.5 degrees centigrade. And we also see there is a gustatory sweating when we take more of a khatupadarda, that too, particularly having a capsaicin. It's called as gustatory sweating. There are different types are described of Sveda Karma, usually based on the considering the different aspects. Snigdha, Ruksha and Sadharana. This is one way of classifying the Sveda Karma. Another one is Agni and Niragni. Agni Sveda are 13 types and Niragni Sveda are 10 types. And the other aspect is Mrudu Sveda, Madhyama Sveda and Mahasveda. Mrudu Sveda usually you apply in testicle region, heart region and eyes. Whereas Madhyama Sveda in groins, penis and joints, and Mahasveda is remaining bodily parts. And Ekanga Sveda and Sarvanga Sveda. Samshamaniya Sveda and Samshodhana Sveda. And Bahya Sveda and Abhyantara Sveda. So there are different kinds of considering the different aspects of applicability. And Agni Siveda, that is thermal sedation. And different acharyas, acharya Susruta and Vagbhat have the, one kind of opinion, and Acharya Charaka has given a different sedation. And Acharya Charaka mentioned there are 13 types, and those 13 types were maybe considered the 4 types which is given by the Acharya Susruta. So that is Tapa, which is usually advisable in the copper dominant conditions, that is giving a direct heat. And Ushma Sveda, it is again in a kapha, that is steam. And Upanaha Sveda, particularly advisable in water dominant conditions, in it's a kind of application of poultice. And Drava Sveda Pitta, that is pitta dominant conditions in hot liquids. So the 14 types, the 13 types given by the Acharaka can be considered under the heading of these 4 types as mentioned by Acharya Susruta and Vagbhata. Coming to the Niragni Sveda, non-thermal sedation. And there are 13 types. So Vyayama is we consider as a Vyayama. There are, when you exercise, naturally body perspires. So it is Niragni, means it's no way, it is a no contact with any heat. So that's it's called as categories under Niragni Sveda. Examples, we see it is more advisable in Urustamba, Stavli and Prameh. And Ushna Sadhana and Nivata Sadhana. Is also kind of Niragni Sveda, it is advisable in Kusta and Udara Roga. Guru Pravarna is advisable in Jvara. Kshuda is advisable in Udara and Rajayakshma Roga. And Bahupanam is a kind of Niragni Sveda which usually you see in Medatyaya cases advisable. Baya in Urmada cases. And Krodha and Amarsha, that is Bayotpada Unmada as Pratidvanda Chikitsa. Upanaha, Vatarakta, Sandhigata Vata and Pranashopa. And Ahata Niyut, that is which is could see in image which is visible in the slide, that is Hatistaulya. Atapa, that is insulation in Siddha and Kilasa Kushta. Advagamana in Prameha Vyadi and Baraharana, that is Prameha Vyadi, Chinta usually we see. So this particular Niragni Sveda is more advisable in Kaphamedo Samsrishta Vata, that is we can say endogenous production of sweat. And when the condition arises, when it is a Sveda Karma is supposed to be applied in pediatrics, that is childhood age group. So there are again it is mentioned as an Avastika Sveda, Hasta Sveda, Pradeha Sveda, Nadisteha, Prastara Sveda, Sankara Sveda, Upanaha Sveda, Avagaha Sveda and Parisheka Sveda. So if Jatasya Chatro Masan Hasta Sveda Prayujayat, if then an infant of 4 months, there we are supposed to advise Hasta Svedam. Sveda Karma and benefits. So, you know, Sveda Karma is thermoregulatory sweating. Sitopaha Aranam, that it relieves coldness. Shula Haranam relieves pain. Stambha Nigraham relieves stiffness. Gaurava Nigraham, that is relieves heaviness. Mardavam promotes softness of the skin. Vata Niyamanam regulation of Vata. Gatra Vinamanam relaxes body. Agnidipanam promotes digestion. Sandhi Cheshtakar improves joint movements. Nidra Tandra Haram corrects excessive sleep and drowsiness. Sveda Karma, you may consider as an artificial fever. It raises temperature of the tissues. Elevated temperature kills pathogens and helps healing. Fever is a curative process, a defensive process, a life-saving expedient. Influence of hyperparexia and several physiological and immunological processes. Immunological process is boosted because your body temperature is your system fights this artificial fever. And there are contraindications for Sveda Karma. Pitta Prakruti and Pitrogi usually contraindicated. Persons with hungry, thirst, dry mouth and anger, voracious appetite, alcohol, drug abuse. Persons who consumed milk, curd, honey and snehadravyasa as per Vagbhata. Atistula is also contraindicated. Garbini, Pushpitam, Sutika, Madhumeha and Kamala Udara, and there are different clinical conditions where Sveda Karma is not advisable. Still, if you, as a physician, you have, if you wish, if you feel that we need an Sveda Karma, then Alpa Sveda can be applied. Ati Sveda, hyperhidrosis. So, it is also discussed in Ayurveda. So, the symptoms usually we see Vishada and Murcha, Daha, Trishna, Pitta Prakopa, Arati, Swarahani, Angadorbalya, Vyakulata. And the treatment which is advised by Charaka as a Grishma Rutu Charya and Kashyapa as Visarpa Chikitsa and Vagbhata as Stambhana Chikitsa. So, as per the availability and the yukti of the physician, you may apply whatever you wish to want. And Svedakarma is not only described in there are different forms, though it is not truly applied as in a therapeutic purpose, but there are different kinds, and Svedakarma is available in different cultures. So, this you may go through this. Physiological effects of heat. So, heat as such has in its influence on the metabolic effects and vascular and soft tissue extensibility and neuromuscular level. If you look at this metabolic, heat increases the metabolic rate 2 to 3 fold, and of course increases oxygen consumption, increases phagocytosis, increases arterial dilatation, blood flow locally, increases output of waste products and metabolites, tissue damage if occur when the temperature is more than 45 degrees centigrade. That is again needs a point of caution. Vascular effects, heat increases the tissue temperature, usually associated with vasodilation, increases in blood flow, increases nutrients and leukocytes to that area, increases capillary permeability and fluid exchange, decreases pain and muscle spasm. And when it comes to the neuromuscular effects, it causes general relaxation, decreases pain and skin impedance, decreases muscle spasm and spasticity, increases nerve conduction velocity and neuronal firing. And soft tissue extensibility, increases extensibility of collagen, decreases joint stiffness. There is a somatosensory system where both Snehakarma and Svedakarma both gives the effects, and this is how by both Snehakarma and Svedakarma this particular system is directly involved, and the systemic effects on being induced by through modulation of the somatosensory system. And how this sweat is being produced by neurological control? Initially there is an activation of sensory receptors which is present in the skin and stimulus in the nerve ending, depolarization of nerve ending, and further initiates action potential and nerve impulse, transduction and the release of neurotransmitters, chemical signal at synaptic junction, carry forward to spinal cord, primary somatosensory area that is located in postcentral gyrus. From there it is reaches the parietal lobe of cerebral cortex, integrating and processing center, and from there it is sympathetic postganglionic motor neurons which sends the signals to sweat gland receptors which further releases sweat production. And Svedakarma, it is definitely a therapeutic heat. It contact with the warmed substances, usually there will be a transition of heat by conduction. Sweat from exercise is not effective as Svedakarma. People when we ask them to undergo this particular Svedakarma, Bhaswa Sveda, so they say that we usually go to the gym, their body perspires. But definitely the perspiration by doing in a physical exercise and the perspiration by the Sneha Svedakarma is something which is different. Because as exercise activates sympathetic nervous system which enables the toxin elimination, whereas in the Sneha Svedakarma it modulates the parasympathetic system, it further allows the toxin elimination from the body. So the most immediate and noticeable effect is tremendous relaxation which usually has a profound impact on health, and it reduces the viscosity of blood resulting in the lowering of blood pressure. It increases the viscosity of the synovial fluid which is beneficial in osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis. Improves the function of the cardiovascular system such that it heart works harder to increase the peripheral circulation therapy, oxygen rich blood will be supplied continuously, and it promotes cell regeneration and stimulates hypothalamus which controls neurochemicals involved in sleep, mood and pain. Svedakarma we have different local pain management, we call it as a non-pharmacological pain management modalities. There are many. So that is Valuka Sveda and Ishtika Sveda, Mrittika Sveda, Salvana Sveda, Tushapinda Sveda, Churna Sveda, Patrapotali Sveda, Jambiranda Sveda, Vachakshira, Bhashpa Sveda, Shastika Shalipinda Sveda and Mamsakidi. If you go from Valuka Sveda to Mamsakidi, the Valuka Sveda is Atyanta Ruksha and whereas Mamsakidi is Atyanta Brahmana. So as go down Valuka to Ishtika to Mrittika to and from Patrapotali to end, the Rukshata is coming down and the Snigdha is increasing, and the highest Snigdha is Mamsakidi. Again it is a kind of Svedakarma, it falls under the category of Svedakarma as a broader perspective. And coming to the Valuka Sveda, as the more it is Rukshana, we call it as a sand fermentation. And in the sand, you know, the most sand is a granular material made up of small pieces that can move separately and together. And this most abundant material which is present in the sand is silica, that is quartz, it's a rich in organic material. And it has a property of thermal inertia, medium thermal inertia, that is it easily gets heat and easily gets cooled down. So its ability of material to conduct and store the heat. And this the sand which is the rich of silica, as how it's acts as a therapeutic agent. Silica is a compound made out of the two most abundant elements in the earth's crust, that is silicon and oxygen. And silicon is not found free in nature but occurs chiefly as silica. And it is important plant and animal life essential trace, and the highest level of silicon in humans are found in the skin. It is very interesting point, and the connective tissue is essential for their integrity. Collagen, a primary component of connective tissue and a third of all body proteins, rich in silicon. Elastin is also rich in silicon. French research suggests that silicon helped to prevent osteoporosis and can be used to treat bone fracture. Silica in close cooperation with vitamin C has the ability of holding moisture in tissues through compounds known as mucopolysaccharides, also known as glycosaminoglycans. These mucilaginous carbohydrates together with collagen and elastin make up the connective tissues. And we may consider this Valuka Sveda as IR therapy, infrared therapy, because infrared rays are the vital energy important for the health maintenance, including the growth of the livings. And this particular ceramic compounds in sand holds back the IR rays, infrared rays, and on heating radiates IR heat. So naturally, when we take Valuka Sveda, we tie up in a Eranda Patra. So in between we heat that sand, and whenever we heat that sand, it emits IR rays, and it gives the similar effect to whatever we do in IR therapy in the physical medicine. So that's how, even in addition to that, even our bodies also have the effect to have the capacity to radiate far infrared energy through the skin in between 3 to 50 microns. Chinese palm healing based on natural healing properties of fire, that is far infrared rays, palm emit energy in between 14 microns. And these are the available in some research article published. They took up the spectral wave pictometry images. How when a physiological heat increases the peripheral circulation in the body. There are the images which are given on the left side are the before the application of heat therapy, that is Veda Karma, and after therapy. So we could see the ray increase in the red color. That's what it implies, that increased peripheral circulation. And Sveda Karma is also considered as for the transdermal nutrition. There are two procedures usually we do, that is Shastika Shali Pinda Sveda, that is in other words we call it as an Avarakidi, and Sarvangadharva in other words we call it as spiritual. So whatever we apply on the skin or gets absorbed through that's called as a transcutaneous absorption. You know, the major barrier in the skin is stratum corneum, which has in cells and intracellular lipid in a bricks and mortar model. So it's a major barrier, and the dermis, which has in a subpapillary network, it drugs diffuse into the vascular system. And anything which is usually crosses through the skin when it has in continuous contact with the skin for a considerable time, that may be from hours to days, so it's called as passive diffusion because of the concentration gradient. And you know, highly lipophilic compounds with low molecular weight are ideal for better absorption. And there are different pathways. We may consider this transcellular pathways for direct absorption for Navarakidi, and intra and paracellular pathway, that is a common pathway for lipophilic compounds in a physical, and follicular route, that is for direct acid dermis, is less important, particularly in the Dravadhara. So hydrated skin is more repairable than dry skin, that is Thakkar Sarvangadhara, there where Kashayadhara, Navadanyadhara, where follicular root is the side absorption way, pathway. And coming to the Sarvangadhara, we make it as an oil bathing. So it's a combination of Snehan and Svedana and Shamana and Shodhana. So this is such a procedure, Sarvangadhara is such a procedure, it gives both Shamana benefits and Shodhana benefits and Brahmana benefits also. And this thermal bathing increases hydrostatic pressure on the body. It's a continuous pouring of oil or any medicated liquid onto the body. So from the 8 inches on the, so that's how it generates hydrostatic pressure on the body, thus increasing blood circulation and cell oxygenation. This increase in blood flow also helps in dissolving and eliminate toxins from the body. So it shows effects like the TENS, that is transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. It's a non-pharmacological, non-invasive electroanalgesia. So endogenous, it's a kind of endogenous pain control. It causes release of endorphin and increases the pain threshold. So that's how there are the studies which support the evidence that there isn't a chance for transdermal absorption of castor oil. So this particular is available in this particular article. There is evidence based integrated schema. You go through details of this article. And another one is Navarakidi, the healing touch, Shastika Shalipinda Sveda. So there is a study report from Kerala Agriculture University. They found that the typical protein which is found in Navara rice, that is Shastika Shali, that is Baumannburg trypsin inhibitor protein, that is called as BBI protein. It is small water soluble protein with molecular weight of 8000 Daltons. And the point here, the question comes is, so you know, something which, anything which is ideal for the absorption, transdermal, transcutaneous absorption, is it should be in a lipophilic compound and should have a low molecular weight. When it comes to BBA protein, it is, you know, water soluble protein having the high molecular weight. So how this particular this protein and this Navarakidi gives systemic effect having the opposite qualities which is supposed to have for the transcutaneous absorption. The reason this particular Shastika Shali, we boil it in milk. The moment we boil this this particular Shastika Shali in the milk, thus particular compound is which the BBI protein, the complex protein, the BBI and the casein protein, which will become lipophilic, and the complex protein, the molecular weight is lesser, which allows this particular complex, that is BBI protein, casein protein complex, to absorb easily through the transcutaneous route. So it's proved that it's anti-carcinogenic, phenocopriotic property, anti-inflammatory, anti-allergic properties in animals. And it's cellulite is a condition, a clinical, it's a cosmetic condition where skin of lower limbs, abdomen and pelvic region becomes dimpled after puberty. So simply we get the fat gone wrong, and where usually regular in between the where it's usually advised Vedakarma for the cosmetic ones, where regular application of the Snehana and followed with an steam which gives a strength to the skin, and the further the condition will not be, and condition may be stabilized. And this is an how difference between normal fat cell and the fat cell in the cellulite. And this is an images which showing the difference between the cellulite and Svedakarma, how this current concept of physical medicine, there are different modes of application of heat therapy. We see hot packs and paraffin and whirlpool, fluid therapy, IR radiation, ultrasound, diathermy and thermotherapy. There are different way in the physical medicine they apply the heat to the locally and systematically the different bodily parts. So it's a application of contemporary application of Svedakarma. So thank you one and all.